Bonjour mes amis, Matt Easton ici. This is a cabbage cutter, cabbage chopper, and it's the 1831 pattern French chouchou, I believe. I can't pronounce the French very well, but essentially it means cabbage cutter or cabbage chopper. And it does look a bit like a gladius, doesn't it? And that's what the French certainly thought, and that seems to be what it's modelled after. Now, it's interesting that in the 18th century, we see that infantry, very often, despite the fact their primary weapon is a musket with a bayonet on attached, across Europe, it was still really, really normal for infantry soldiers to carry some type of sidearm. And that was either a type of briquette type, you know, hanger type thing, like a mini saber essentially, or one of these. These kind of came in, but these were particularly carried by artillery and all sorts of kind of support troops, as well as some infantry as well. So essentially it was a sidearm, but was it any good as a sidearm? Well, we have some anecdotal evidence that these were very, very rarely used as weapons. Now, of course, the primary weapons, if you've got a musket, you're going to be mostly shooting at people. Even if you're in skirmishing or scouting, you're going to be mostly, if you're not shooting them, bayoneting them. And the anecdotal evidence and sort of period accounts suggest that these were predominantly used as tools, famously for cutting firewood. And actually, you know, in that kind of capacity, it would work pretty damn well. These are solidly made, I should say. So these are quite beefy, thick blades. They're thicker than gladiuses actually really were. They're heavier than gladiuses were because, of course, they've got a solid brass hilt. And that brass hilt is put onto a thick tang that is peened at the end there. So it's an incredibly solid construction, as tough really is a cutlass. Cutlasses have cast metal hilts, and so indeed do these. These are solid brass. You do get other countries have variations on these, which sometimes have steel hilts, but the French ones are famously brass. The French loved brass on their hilts, for the officers' swords, for cavalry swords. For some reason, the French absolutely loved brass. And it should also be mentioned that various other militaries around the world copied this and other French models of sword. Countries that copied French models of sword included Spain, Russia, and the United States of America. And in fact, the iconic kind of American model 1840 and 1860 cavalry sabers, for example, are copies of the American 1822 light cavalry saber. But the US artillery, for example, gunners did in fact have versions of these as well. They're a little bit different, a model on a slightly different model, but essentially same basic idea. So why did the French have these? Well, there's no question that from Napoleon onwards, the French very much alluded to things that were classical and trying to, through their uniforms and their architecture and their weapons, trying to allude to the fact that they were a sort of a modern Roman Empire. Of course, as it turned out after Napoleon, really Britain was the most powerful world empire, but France was very much up there as well. France was probably the second most influential and powerful military nation of the 19th century. And in terms of pure numbers of soldiers, for example, bigger than Britain really. But nevertheless, they were trying to allude to this ancient world aesthetic. So we notice that it's got a slightly leaf-shaped blade, and that definitely harks back to what they considered to be classical world swords. So we do see a degree of that with things like the Mainz Gladius, for example. It doesn't really look like this. This is almost more like an earlier, it's almost like a Bronze Age shaped blade, actually, like the Ewart Park type Bronze Age sword. But of course, made in steel. And as mentioned, they are thick, very solid blades. If sharpened, they do cut really quite well, although I have to say they're quite cumbersome. So if you wanted to make this a better weapon without really changing its shape very much, just simply making the blade lighter and making the hilt lighter would make it a better weapon. These are really beefy things. They're as heavy as a cavalry sword, but in a shorter form. Why? Well, partly, I suppose, because they believed that infantry soldiers should have a sidearm that was indeed, that they couldn't fail to hurt someone with. So sharp or not, if you give someone a good, I mean, it's a bit like an edged metal truncheon. Whether it's sharp or not, you're still going to do a lot of damage with this thing. But equally, I think they probably knew, and Alfred Hutton alludes to this in one of his books, that the common recruit, the ranker, kind of had a tendency of abusing their weapons. So for example, if we look at a modern military rifle, it will generally be a bit overbuilt compared to a target rifle because it needs to sustain hard campaigning life. And it's true of these things as well. They knew that any type of sidearm that they gave out to regular infantry was going to get abused. It was going to get used for chopping wood. It was probably going to get used for breaking and levering and all sorts of jobs that it wasn't really ideally designed for. So they kind of partially designed it for those jobs to make it more effective at doing the things that it wasn't really supposed to do, which is an interesting design ethos when you think about it. And I think this applied to firearms as well. So as a weapon, is it very good? Well, not great. So by and large, you're much better off in a one-on-one fight. The person with a bayonet on the end of their musket is going to have a huge advantage over someone using one of these. But I have to say, there are times when a bayonet will break, or when you're in fighting in a building, for example, or when you're in a very dense melee where you just can't really use, or even a trench, actually. And this is, of course, where trench fighting weapons came in World War I. There are situations where you can't really deploy what's essentially a heavy short spear, that is a musket and bayonet, when one of these might be useful. I don't personally know of any other accounts of these being used in combat, but that being said, these are a distinctly French style of sword. We did actually have a few of these in Britain. We actually did import some of these and experiment with them. I know because the Royal Armouries own some with British markings on, and I have seen ones with British markings in the past. I suspect that they were never issued. We did have a similar type of sword to this, known as, well, that was used by bandsmen, so it's known as generically known as the bandsman sword. There are in fact several different models of them, but the bandsman sword is lighter than this, and actually in some ways I'd say maybe a better weapon than this, although this is a better tool. So if you want to chop wood up, this is better. If you want to fight people, probably the British bandsman sword is a better weapon. But nevertheless, these are quite common things. They're not uncommon to find, and they were used over a long period of time, really, from the Napoleonic era right the way through and still until they were still kind of generally speaking around at the end of the 19th century. And I'm sure they're still being used as tools into the early 20th century. So if you go to antique shops in France, you will find these quite commonly. And for that reason, they're not uncommon to find in Britain as well, because tourists spring them back. But of course, there have been two world wars which have gone through France involving thousands of British soldiers, so lots of these got brought back as souvenirs. And in some cases, maybe these were used later as personal weapons of offence, defence. Maybe they've been used in crime, maybe they were used occasionally in World War One trench raiding, I don't know. What I would say to you is, if you know of any accounts of these being used in actual combat, then by all means let me know. Maybe I've got some French viewers out there, or Belgian maybe viewers, who've actually seen accounts of these being used in combat. I don't know. If I was going to use one of these, how would I use it? Well, essentially, I'd kind of use it like a heavy machete, I suppose. It's got no hand protection, so you're for the most part not, I wouldn't advise against anybody with a, well, certainly against no one with a sword or an edged weapon holding it out in front. If the opponent's got a bayonet, it's a slightly different situation, because they can only stab at your hand and you can actually move it out of the way fairly easily. But trying to cross and close on them will be the way forward, definitely. So holding it far out in front and trying to cross the incoming bayonet is the way to go. Cross, grab, and then get in close and start hacking and stabbing. Against someone with, for example, a saber, if someone's coming at you with a saber with this, well, generally speaking, I think you'll want to, if you look at like German Langmesser techniques from the 15th, 16th century, or Dussac perhaps, keeping the hand a bit further back and only moving the hand out to intercept the incoming blows will be the way to go. And remember that with a shorter blade, despite the fact you've got less reach to hit, you've actually got the advantage advantage in defending, at least in terms of when you actually make contact, if you successfully put it in the right place. By catching the blade on here, it's all strong, essentially. So if you catch the opponent's saber blade anywhere on this short blade, you've got quite a good point of leverage there, but it's all going to be about closing. So assuming the opponent has a longer weapon than you, you're going to want to cross and close, cross and close. That's your priority with this. But having no knuckle bow even, and no complex handguard at all, does make that somewhat challenging against someone with a long weapon. Against someone with a shorter weapon, like a knife, this is actually great because it's a big knife, it's a big heavy knife. So if you were involved in some type of, street patrol or something like that, where rioters, French revolutionaries, whatever, jump out and try and take you, this actually might be a really good weapon. If they're assaulting you with sticks or knives or bottles or this type of thing, then this actually might be a really good self-defense implement. Although I still think it's somewhat on the heavy side. So there we go. That is the cabbage cutter, cabbage chopper, shoe. And merci bien for watching, and I hope that I can talk more about some French weapons in the future. Cheers, folks. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe. We've got extra videos on Patreon, t-shirts on Spreadshirt, and I hope to see you for the next video.